Penguin Audio presents The Master Key to Riches by Napoleon Hill, read by Joel Fotinos. The Prologue. I give and bequeath to the American people the greater portion of my vast fortune, which consists in the philosophy of individual achievement through which all of my riches were accumulated. Thus began the last will and testament of one of the richest men that the richest nation on earth ever produced, and it now serves as the beginning of the prologue of a story that may well mark the most important turning point in the lives of all who read it. This story first began in the late fall of 1908, when Andrew Carnegie called in a man whom he trusted and whose integrity and judgment he respected, and entrusted to him what Mr. Carnegie said was the greater portion of his vast fortune, with the understanding that the legacy was to be presented to the American people. Today, nearly 100 years later, his story has been written to notify you of your right to share in this huge estate and to inform you as to the conditions under which you may do so. Lest you do the perfectly natural thing that many would do, that of reaching the false conclusion that the conditions under which you may share in this huge estate are too rigid to permit you to comply with them, let me relieve your mind by saying that the conditions are well within the reach of any adult of average intelligence, and there are no tricks or false hopes either in connection with the conditions or in this promise. So that you may know whether or not this promise is anything you need or desire, let me tell you what it does promise. A clear description of the formula by which you may have the full benefit of the master key to riches, a key that should unlock the doors to the solution of all your problems, that will help you convert all of your past failures into priceless assets, and that leads you to the attainment of the 12 great riches, including economic security. An inventory of the vast riches which Andrew Carnegie provided for distribution to those who are qualified to receive them, together with detailed instructions through which you may appropriate and use your full share. A description of the means by which you may have the full benefit of the education, experience, and technical skill of those whose cooperation you may need for the attainment of your major purpose in life, thus providing a practical means by which you may bridge the disadvantages of an inadequate education and attain the highest goals of life as successfully as may those who are blessed with a formal education. The privilege of using the philosophy of success, which was organized from the life experiences by the trial and error method of more than 500 successful men and women, among whom are Henry Ford, Thomas A. Edison, Charles M. Schwab, F. W. Woolworth, Dr. Alexander Graham Bell, Clarence Darrow, and Luther Burbank. A definite plan by which anyone who works for wages or a salary may promote him or herself into a higher income with the full consent and cooperation of his or her employer. A definite plan through which anyone who works for others may get into a business or profession of his or her own with more than average chances of success. A definite plan through which any business person may convert his or her customers into permanent clients, and through their willing cooperation, add new customers who will likewise become permanent. You have here a clear statement of my promise, and the first condition under which you may benefit by these is that you listen to this audiobook twice, and listen closely. Nothing ever happens without a definite cause. It was by no mere chance that the United States came to be known as the richest and the freest country of the world. This is a land of plenty because of definite, understandable causes, each of which we have clearly defined. The desire for plenty may be selfish, but we all know that it is a natural desire. Andrew Carnegie understood this when he decided to give away his huge fortune. But guided as he was by the wisdom of a lifetime of practical experience in dealing with people, he safeguarded his gift by attaching to it certain conditions with which all who receive any part of it must comply. Mr. Carnegie adopted a novel method for the distribution of his riches, because he recognized the weakness of humankind in wanting something for nothing. He knew that people in all walks of life, all down through the past, have been looking for a land flowing with milk and honey. He also knew that the gift of riches in any form, without some sort of consideration in return, generally harms more than it benefits the one who receives it. Therefore, he wisely attached to his gift certain conditions by which those who receive it are protected against this common weakness of desiring something for nothing. Looking into history, Mr. Carnegie recognized that this desire for something for nothing was the object of the search of the scouts who were sent out by Moses and Joshua because the children of Israel, after they had worked in slavery in Egypt for many years, making brick without straw, had escaped the pharaohs and were waiting after a long period in the wilderness for an opportunity to cross over the sea into the land of plenty. The glowing description of plenty in that land served as the incentive which enabled their leaders against strong opposition to hold the solidarity of the people until they reached their objectives. A counterpart of this same story is found in the migration of subdued people from England to the New World. They came not only in search of a land of material plenty, but for a land which afforded plenty of opportunities for the expression of personal initiative, freedom of worship, and freedom of speech, and the very purpose of their migration served as an assurance of the success of the most outstanding step ever taken by any group in modern history. They developed a land of plenty. The plenty came from their efforts simply because their endeavors were based upon a sound philosophy, a constructive objective, which Andrew Carnegie recognized centuries later, and he not only converted it into a huge fortune for himself, but he left to the American people of today a simple set of rules, a master key, by which they too may acquire riches. Out of their pioneering toil down through the years, the descendants of those pilgrims of progress have built a civilization never before known in the history of the world, a culture which exceeds the greatest culture of all times, standards of living which are higher than ever before known to mankind, conveniences, comforts, luxuries, and opportunities available to the humblest person such as the world has never known. All of these advantages were the result of a sound foundation, the foundation stones of a budding new democracy, something new under the sun, a modified form of perfect state, which was destined to prove successful because it was practical. Such a civilization had never before been known in the entire history of mankind. There have been many periods in history when the advance of civilization was heralded with glowing terms, yet the civilization of the particular age in each instance was confined to a relatively small percentage of the people. Thus, we represent a difference between the cultural eras of the past and the culture of today. Study, if you will, the picture of the advantages enjoyed by the American people today, even to the lowliest and the humblest. Free education, free entertainment, radio, television, the automobile, the airplane, the network of free highways, advanced modes of communication, free worship. These and thousands of other advantages denied to the peasants of the past are now the common property of all of the people in America today. This difference, which is due to the fundamental difference in motives and objectives, has been made possible because of practical developments under the American way of life. In America, men and women have been free to follow the dictates of their own consciences. They have had freedom of worship, freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of political convictions, and freedom for the fullest exercise of their own personal initiative in any calling of their choice, and they have been protected by a form of government which assured them the fruits of their labors. This has arisen out of the fact that freedom, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness constituted the basis of the development of our country, with its program of plenty as the goal of every citizen. As workers began to express their personal initiative as individuals, and later as groups, and later still for security and protection as corporations, with the capital.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.